good to see y'all this morning on this wet morning. Make you aware that at the end of the service today, we're having a wedding. Y'all can't sit together before you get married? Oh, the baby's up there. That's what. But there is a wedding at the end of the service today, so it won't take long. You're invited to stay, and you can all be witnesses, and Dalton will pay you $5 a piece for every witness. Isn't that right, Dalton? Or is that Blaine that was going to pay that for you? Oh, okay. All right. But anyways, so that it won't be long. Won't be any music. Now, I know some of you said you weren't going to be here tonight. I was talking with Jim and Ray. As of right now, we're still going to have services tonight. If anything changes, we'll let you know. But how many of you, let me just ask you this real quick, like just looking around. How many of you know you will not be here tonight? All right, throw your hand back up. I'm not trying to shame you. If you know you won't be here tonight, we'll let you know. But right now, as of right now, we're having services, okay? That'd be tonight. Announcements next Sunday, 10:30 a.m. right here, Christmas Eve service. It'll be in here, 10:30, no Bible study. The worship, everything starts at 10:30 right in here next Sunday morning, okay? New Year's Eve, we will have regular services. On that Sunday night, New Year's Eve, the 31st, we're going to have we're just going to meet in the social hall that night. You bring finger foods, fix a dish, bring a bag of chips, go pick up a bucket of chicken, just bring food. And if you got a board game, we'll just spend some time over there in fellowship. And that'll be our evening service. And then when everybody gets ready to go, I've got a board game I'm going to bring. I think some of you might enjoy playing. But if you got something, just a little activity as we close out the year, that'll be on Sunday, December 31st for that. Anything else as far as announcements? All right. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer, and we'll get started here. Father, we do thank you for this opportunity to be here. I know it's been stormy weather through the night. I pray for those that are out working. I know that there are some without power. So we pray for the power crews that are out working for their safety. I know Stevie's having to deal with pump stations. I pray for those that are working with him on that to resolve those issues. Lord, again, we just thank you that we can be here and worship together today. We ask that the name of Jesus would be lifted up here and be magnified, that, Lord, you would be pleased with our worship of you today. And we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Let's all stand if we're able and sing loud.
my Savior, I come to thee.
Brother Stevie Boy, amen. You may be seated.
See?
strife the world has suffered long. Beneath the angel's strain have rolled 2,000 years of wrong. And man at war with man hears not the love song which they bring. Oh, hush the noise, ye men of strife, and hear the angels sing. For lo, the days are hastening on, by prophet March foretold, when with the ever circling years comes round the age of gold, when peace shall over all the earth its ancient splendors fling, and the whole world give back the song which now the angels sing.
We're going to have some special singing.
In the dark and all alone, growing comfortable, are you too scared to move and walk out of this tomb? Buried underneath the lies that you believe, safe and sound, stuck in the ground, too lost to be found. You're just asleep, and it's time. Said your name, the thing that filled your veins was more than blood, the kind of love that washes sin away. Now the door is open wide, and the stones flew all aside. The old is gone, the light has come, so come on and rise up. Take a breath, you're alive now. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? You're brand new. How death couldn't hold you? Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us out from the grave like Lazarus? Rise up, rise up, rise up, out from the grave like Lazarus. He's calling us to walk out of the dark. Oh, he's given us new resurrected hearts. Oh, he's calling us to walk out of the dark. He's given us new resurrected hearts. Come on, rise up, take a breath, you're alive now. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us? Out from the grave at last, it's your brand new. How death couldn't hold you? Can't you hear the voice of Jesus calling us? Out from the grave at last.
I know who this belongs to. Well, that belongs to you, Ray. All right. Take your Bibles and go to Matthew chapter 1. Matthew chapter 1. Just want to, it is Christmas season. I don't always preach a lot of messages on Christmas. Not going to really preach anything that you've not heard before if you've been in church much. But I want us to just focus on and remember the reason Jesus came. And so we're going to be in Matthew chapter 1. I'm going to read verses 18 through 25. We're going to hone in on verses 21 through 23. We'll be kind of like the springboard of where we kick off at. But I want us just to, again, be reminded of why Jesus came for us. So if you have your Bibles open, Matthew chapter 1, verse 18, I ask you and invite you to stand with me if you're able as we read God's word together through the end of this chapter. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not wanting to make her a public example, was minded to put her away secretly. But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. So all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us. Then Joseph, being aroused from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him and took to him his wife and did not know her till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. You may be seated, and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for this time of worship this morning, for these that have assembled here together. Lord, as we open your word up, Lord, as we look to your word, may we be reminded of the reason that Jesus came. Jesus didn't just come to create a holiday, but he came to save us from our sins. And we thank you for that. And Father, I pray that you would help us to keep that fresh in our minds during this time of year. And we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, we get to this Christmas season, and there, you see it on advertising, whether it be on TV, whether it be on the internet, Facebook or Instagram or any of these other social media outlets. You hear it on the radio if you're listening. You'll see it in papers. There's all this advertising about Christmas, and everybody just talks about Christmas, Christmas, Christmas. But again, without Christ, there is no Christmas. I mean, there really isn't. It's not just a holiday that's become something secular, although that is what has happened with a lot of people. Christmas is about Christ and the birth of Christ. Now, we're not ever told in Scripture that the early church ever celebrated the birth. And why is that? Well, because when Jesus was born, even though the shepherds were told and the wise men came, it was not viewed by most everybody outside of his family to be anything significant, because they didn't realize that the Messiah had been born, that he had come. And it was later, after his crucifixion, his burial, and his resurrection, and his ascension back to heaven, it was centuries later that the church began to celebrate the birth, the fact that God came to this earth. It is significant because God entered into his creation. And Jesus came, he says in Luke 19:10, that Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. He came on a mission to redeem. He came on a mission to ransom. He came on a mission to save us from our sins. And that's the first thing, is that he came to redeem us from sin's penalty. It says here in verse 21 of Matthew 1, and she will bring forth a son, and you should call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. People need saving. Lost people oftentimes don't realize. They said, what do I need to be saved from? You need to be saved from the penalty of your sins. You need to be saved from the penalty that God's wrath will be poured out upon you if you do not receive his son. God has sent his son as payment for our sins, and if we reject his son, we will experience his wrath. But Jesus came that we might not experience the wrath of God, that we might know the love of God, and that we might know God himself. And so he came to seek and to save that is lost. And he came to redeem us. And the word redeem means to rescue, to ransom, to deliver. And that's exactly what he did when he says he will save his people from their sins. He came to save us. In Galatians chapter 3, the Apostle Paul said it like this, and we may look at chapter 4 a little bit in our service next week. But in Galatians chapter 3, verses 13 and 14, the Apostle Paul says there that Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles in Christ Jesus, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. So he said here, he has redeemed us from the curse of the law. We were under the curse of the law. We could not fulfill the law perfectly. You might not break all the law, but you have broken some of the law. And the word of God is clear. If you break one, you are guilty of all. That's what Paul tells us in the book of Romans. So once you have sinned, you are a lawbreaker. And you are under the curse of the law. But Jesus came to redeem us from the curse of the law. And he did that by going to the cross. Over in chapter 4, Paul says there in Galatians 4, verses 4 through 7, but when the fullness of the time had come. Now, you've heard me say this before. People ask, why did Jesus come 2,000 years ago? I mean, had he come today, we've got CNN, we've got Fox News, we've got satellite, we've got the internet, we've got the web. Man, I mean, we could just spread the word so quickly. Now, I want you to just think about it for a second. We could spread the word so quickly. We can still do that today, can we not? Are we spreading the word quickly? Not hardly. And how long does a typical news cycle last? 2-3 days? Sometimes a week? You know, let me ask you this. Other than funding for Ukraine, when's the last time you heard much about the war in Ukraine? About the progress? Have you heard much about that lately? And over in Israel and Gaza, you hear about that, but you don't hear as much about that. You hear some things about it still. It's still there in the forefront. But my point being, a typical news cycle does not last very long. Sandy Rick doesn't put the same paper out every week, although it seems like it sometimes. Tell him I said that. But he puts out a new paper every week. He has to have a new story. If he ran next week, the same paper he ran this week, people would be like, I got last week's paper. And they would be ringing up, and Sandy would have to be explaining why Rick put the same paper out again. Well, he says the news hadn't changed. It's still the same. You know, you don't do that. I mean, news cycles change. And so had Jesus come today with our social media, we'd be on to something new in no time at all. But it says here that in the fullness of time, when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son. The fullness of time, the world, the known world, Greek was the basically international language. It's like English today is recognized as the language of the world. Although not everybody speaks English, it is recognized as the language of the world. And in this day, it was Greek, and it made possible the news to spread quickly. So he says, but when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law. That's us. That we might receive the adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. Therefore, you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. So Jesus came to redeem us, to make us sons, to adopt us into his family. We have been adopted by God. We now have legal authority as his children. We are heirs with Christ because Jesus came. And so when we celebrate Christmas, what we're celebrating is the fact that God would come to this earth and that God would send his son to this earth for us. That should astound us. That should amaze us. But as Vance Havner said, we've gotten so used to hearing it, it no longer amazes us. Amazing grace for many of us is no longer amazing. We have gotten so accustomed to it. Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 1, this idea about being redeemed. He says in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 17, and if you call on the Father, who without partiality judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay here in fear, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers. In other words, no one paid money, gave money for your redemption. I remember when I was a boy, riding my bicycle to the store with a couple of six-packs of Coca-Cola bottles, empty. Some of you know what I'm talking about. Blaine ain't got a clue. Oh, you do? You that old? Have to redeem those bottles. Take those bottles back. And they would give you credit back. And then when I bought two full six-packs of Coke, the credit would go towards the purchase of until you bring those bottles back. Some of you used to redeem the Destination Green stamps. I remember my grandmother collecting. I remember my mother doing that. Collect those stamps, put them in that book, and when you get enough stamps, you could order it out of that catalog, get what you want to redeem. And so we weren't redeemed with stuff like that. He said, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. He came at the right time to redeem us, and he gave himself, he gave his life. Now, I love you. I'm privileged to be called your pastor. But, I might die for one of you. I mean, you were out there after church and we're standing in the parking lot, which that won't happen today with the wind blowing and that mist and rain, we won't stand there very long. But if we were out there and all of a sudden a car swerved off the road, I know I'd do this for Miss Lucille. I'd probably do it for Miss Linda. I'd do it for Miss Pat. May I do it for you? You ladies, I'd do it for all of y'all. Let me just say that because I start naming names, I'm going to be in big trouble. You say, you wouldn't do it for me, preacher? You know, Wayne's old enough, I was like, well, he lived a good life. But if that car swerved, and I ran over and knocked you out of the way, knocked you to the ground, but the car hit me, I might do that for you. But you know what I wouldn't do for you? I wouldn't take my son if he was over here and shove him into you to knock you out of the way so that he might die instead of you. But that's exactly what God did for us. He gave his son, and Jesus came. He wasn't shoved by God. He came willingly to die for us. That's what God did for us, and that's what Christ did for us. And Jesus became our sin. And 2 Corinthians 5:21, it's what's called the great exchange, that he who knew no sin became our sin, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So he came to redeem us from sin's penalty, but and that ought to create in us a heart of humility. Now, if you write this down, but Deuteronomy chapter 7, verses 6 through 8, is where God reminds the children of Israel that God did not choose you because you were mightier or bigger or stronger than all the other nations. He said he set his love on you because you were small. God, and what that creates in us should be a heart of humility, that God loved us enough that he would save us. It should not create in us an arrogance like, oh, God saved me, I was somebody special. No, you're special because he saved you. God didn't save you because you were special. You're special because he saved you. Okay? And because of that, and I hope that makes sense the way I said that, but we shouldn't be arrogant towards somebody else. We should be merciful to those that do not yet know Christ and hope that they will come to know Christ. It should create in us a heart of humility. So he came to redeem us from sin's penalty, but he also came to release us from sin's power, so that we would not be bound. So when he says that he will save his people from their sins, it's not just about releasing us from sin's penalty, it's also setting us free from sin's power. In Romans chapter 7, the Apostle Paul says it like this. In Romans 7, beginning in verse 24, bleeding over into the 8th chapter, but he says it like this: "O wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh the law of sin. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. On account of sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit." So he came to redeem us from sin's penalty, but he also came to release us from sin's power. We don't have to be bound by sin's power anymore. Sin does not have to have control over us. We choose to sin. We give sin its power. We resurrect sin's power in our lives when we do not submit to the Holy Spirit that God has given us. And he's also set us free from the fear of death. See, by setting us free from sin's penalty and from sin's power, he also released us from the fear of sin. Or the fear of death, rather. In Hebrews chapter 2, I'll read this text at funerals sometimes, but in Hebrews 2, verse 14, "Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself, Jesus, likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. For indeed he does not give aid to angels, but he does give aid to the seed of Abraham." So, he has set us free. We don't have to worry about death. Now, listen, I do give thought to how I might die, but I don't have to worry about death itself. I don't have to be fearful of death. 1 Corinthians 15, the end of that chapter, verses 50 through 58, Paul says, "Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, great, where is your power at? It's been broken." By whom? By Jesus. So, Steve, had you not pulled it through, yes, Teresa would have been a wreck there. But Steve told me before the surgery, I'm at peace. Now, I'm sure there were moments he questioned that in the hospital a little bit, you know, laying there with tubes everywhere. But at the same time, you don't have to have that fear of death. Like, Lord, if you're ready to take me. Adrian Rogers, as he lay in the hospital, they had him, I'm not sure if he was on the ventilator, but he was conscious enough. And he told his wife, Miss Joyce, and his family, as he lay in that bed, knowing that he's probably not going to recover, he just said to them, I'm at peace. I'm at peace. Because death, for a child of God, is just like walking over to that door or going to that door and just opening it and going through to the other side. As Jake Hess sang years ago with Hovey Lister and the Statesman, death ain't no big deal. Why? Because we know that when we step through that doorway, we step into the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ for those who have received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. For those who have not, they go through a doorway, but it's not Jesus on the other side. It's an into eternity separated from Christ. So he came to redeem us from sin's penalty, but he also came to release us from sin's power, and finally, he came to remove us from sin's presence. Don't you long for a day when you don't have to struggle with sinful thoughts, sinful desires, sinful behavior, where sin won't be there? See, some of y'all look at me like, man, sin, I don't struggle with sin. What are you talking about? I'll find out where you're at this week, and I'll go cut out in front of you in the highway and see how you respond. I can tell you how I respond sometimes. It ain't like I ought to. We all struggle with sin, and one day we'll be removed. There'll be no more temptation. There'll be no more of that at all. And in the last book of the Bible, in the first book of the Bible, we're told how sin entered the world. But in the last book of the Bible, in the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 21, he says there in verse 4 of Revelation 21, it says, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. Death will be gone. Sickness will be gone. Sorrow will be gone. Sin will be gone. And in verses 22 through 27, John describes what he saw there of the New Jerusalem. He said, but I saw no temple in it, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city had no need of the sun or of the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God illuminated it. The Lamb is its light. And the nations of those who are saved shall walk in its light, and the kings of the earth shall bring their glory and honor into it. Its gates shall not be shut at all by day. There shall be no night there. And they shall bring the glory and the honor of the nations into it. But there shall by no means enter it anything that defiles or causes an abomination or a lie, but only those who are written in the Lamb's book of life. And then in chapter 22, he continues this, verses 1 through 5. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding from the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the middle of its street and on either side of the river was the tree of life, which bore 12 fruits, each tree yielding its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. They shall see his face, and his name shall be on their foreheads. There shall be no night there. They need no lamp nor light of the sun, for the Lord God gives them light, and they shall reign forever and ever. He's talking about the new Jerusalem, that heavenly city, the new heavens and the new earth. But he says in verses 14 and 15, blessed are those who do his commandments, that they may have the right to the tree of life, may enter through the gates into the city. But outside are dogs and sorcerers and sexually immoral and murderers and idolaters and whoever loves and practices a lie. There will be no more trace of sin whatsoever. Jesus came to save us from our sin, to set us free from sin's penalty, to release us from sin's power, And one day we will be removed from sin's presence forever. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. What a day that will be. Would you stand and let's pray. Father, we thank you for your grace that you have given to us. That, Lord, you came in order to redeem us, to save us, to buy us back. Lord, to claim us as your own through a relationship with Jesus Christ. Lord, we give you praise and honor for this. And we magnify the name of Jesus. Lord, just bless this time today. Lord, may we remember what Christmas really is about. Lord, it's more than just saying that Jesus is the reason for the season. And while that is true, it's much deeper than just that. It's more than just a holiday. It's the fact that God entered into this creation in order to rescue us. And we praise you for this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals he's waiting and watching, watching for you.
It's been good to worship with you. This service is now over. If you wish to remain for the wedding, I'm going to ask you just to move a little bit closer to the front. If you wish to go on and beat the Methodist sweet teas, you can go out the door and head that away. But if you're going to stay for the wedding, I need to see Haley and Dalton down here. And I need to talk to them for a minute, and we'll be back with you.